In James, and we're going to continue in chapter 4 today, so I would invite you to turn there in your own Bible or the Pew Bible. The Church Bible reference page is on the screen in front of you, and we will pick up where we left off last week at verse 7 of chapter 4, and we'll read to the end of the chapter. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning, and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Brothers, do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against his brother or judges him speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you are not keeping it, but sitting in judgment on it. There is only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, who are you to judge your neighbor? Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money. Why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast and brag. All such boasting is evil. Anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it sins. This is the inspired word of God. Well, we finished up last week in chapter 4 talking about the friendship that people sometimes have with the world. And we noted that friendship with the world, as James says in verse 5 there, is hatred towards God. It's enmity towards God. And think about this. It's not just compromise. Sometimes I think that's how we would want to define it. But it is really a form of treason. Treason against your Creator and your Savior. John, the apostle, said in his first letter that if you love this world, then the love of the Father is not in you. Wow. So if you're here this morning and you're trying to kind of play both sides of the fence, or trying to have the best of both worlds, as it were, so that you can be called a Christian and you have your salvation and you know you're going to heaven, but at the same time you want to keep one foot in the world, in such a way that you're so close to the edge that you're almost falling off, then you are committing, James would say, treason against God. In many countries, as I recall from some of the training that I had in the military, if you commit treason against the state by selling military secrets or privileged government information, the penalty for that treason is death. What if God dealt with all believers who commit spiritual treason in such a way? But he doesn't, does he? God is a lot more merciful toward us than we deserve. Amen? What this should do for all of us is pour out conviction on our souls, because let's be honest, there's a lot of things in this world that we can be, and maybe we are, drawn to. Now, I just put pictures up there of a few things that came to my mind. We could put pictures of fancy cars, pictures of, you know, professional athletes or of Hollywood stars or what have you. This whole thing might be a little bit more difficult for us who live in America because, you know, we're really saturated and we're so marinated in this consumer-oriented, materialistic culture, and the marketing ploys and the advertising strategies that bombard us as we watch television and listen to the radio and surf the net, all of that puts great pressure on us. But even though third world countries, people may not have those kinds of bombardments, this temptation, I believe, is still part of human nature. And when we give in to that temptation and we set our heart's desires on things of this world, it grieves the Spirit of God. It gives God sorrow. And the word that is used there to describe that is the very same word earlier in the New Testament and even back into the Old, where it talks about grieving someone's death. It's real sorrow. And just like you wouldn't want to do anything that would make your spouse or your children or your parents or anyone else that you love to sorrow or to grieve, we should not do anything to cause God to sorrow or to grieve over us. Think about this. God has made himself vulnerable to us by putting himself into a relationship with us. A relationship. So don't break God's heart by abusing or by ignoring the relationship. Do you ever think about this? That there is real and there is powerful emotion in the heart of God over the things that you do. God cares about what you and I do because he's in a real relationship with us. And just like you care about what your spouse does to you or for you or around you or what your children do, you care because you're in a relationship to them and there's love. Now, I needed to say all of that before we jump into our text for today, verses 7 and following, because James wants to tell us that, to set the context, to set the stage for verse 7, where he says, "Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you." Now, I often hear, and you may as well, hear people say that last part, "Resist the devil, and he'll flee from you," but they completely disconnect it from the first part, "Submit yourself to God." I mean, I hear people rebuking the devil and binding the enemy and taking authority against the demons. And that's all fine. That's good. But let's remember that God needs to be at the forefront. Even the warrior archangel Michael in Jude verse 9 says, when he was disputing with the devil, did not dare to bring a slanderous accusation against him, but rather said, "The Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord rebuke you, not me, the Lord." Apparently, the archangels, and I would assume all the rest of the angels as well, understand very well where the real power and the real authority to do spiritual battle comes from. It comes from God. I don't have it in me, and you don't have it in you. God is the power. Now, God gives us a promise here that if we submit ourselves to him, and most of us don't like that word submit, do we? But if we submit ourselves to him and at the same time resist the devil, then the devil has no option but to flee from us. So Satan flees, get this picture in your mind, when he sees God standing in front of you, because he knows he's just a creature, he's an evil creature, he cannot overcome God. But when he sees you standing in front of God, because you positioned yourself there, he is not afraid of you in the least. He knows he can overcome you. Or at least he thinks he can. This is why it is so important for us to check our pride and to submit ourselves to God. That's why it is so necessary, as he says here, to draw near to God so that he can draw near to you. That's where the power is. We need to hide ourselves in the shadow of the Almighty. We need to be in the refuge of his wings. We need to be moving out in his power, not in our own flesh. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 7, we have this treasure in jars of clay. For what purpose? To show that the all-surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. Not to us. Now, let's remember where the real power is. And let's draw near to God. That is so key in this text. Draw near to God. Every single day, we need to do that. Your devotion time, driving down the road praying, draw near to God. Every single moment of every single day, tap into the power of God as you fight the battles that you have to fight. Don't try proudly to walk out in your own strength, because the Bible says pride goes before a fall. You're just setting yourself up for a fall if you're going to do it in some kind of pride. And James says here in verse 10, humble yourself, humble yourself. We sang that song last week. Probably should have sung it again. In the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Now, James might be thinking about a wonderful verse in Psalm 51, and I would encourage you to read Psalm 51 this week as we prepare to come to the Lord's table. It's a penitence psalm. But David says there, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. God loves a contrite heart, a humble heart, and he's drawn to it like a moth to a flame. He's drawn to it, but he's repulsed, on the other hand, by a proud heart. Verse 6, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Now, look at what James says immediately after he says in verse 8, come near to God and he'll come near to you. How are we supposed to come near to God? I think in verse 9, he explains that. He says, wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves. So that's God's prescription for how we're supposed to draw near to him and experience more grace. He gives more grace when we do this. Now, James isn't saying you should be depressed all the time. He's not saying that. He shouldn't say you should walk around and look like a sad sack so people can see that you're in mourning all the time. You know, this is the guy who begins his letter saying, count it all joy, my brothers, when you encounter various trials. He's not saying that we shouldn't praise the Lord and live with the joy of the Lord as our strength. He's saying, get rid of pride. Put away your sin. Because God cannot draw near to someone who is proud and arrogant and wants to rely on themselves. God is enough of a loving gentleman and a wise father that if someone insists on doing that, he'll say, okay, I'll let you go this far, but okay. Prodigal son story. You want your inheritance? You want to go squander it? Okay. Also, God cannot come near to someone who is holding on to some sin, who loves and cherishes some sin and repeats that sin willfully, intentionally, delighting in that sin. David said in Psalm 66, 18, if you cherished iniquity in your heart, the Lord will not hear you. It slams the door in God's face. God says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. I'm looking for 100% commitment in the relationship here. Friends, you see that the real problem in our relationship with God is never, never God. It's always us, right? It's always us. Because God is perfect and holy and righteous and loving and just. It's not God. He gives 100% to his relationship with us. In fact, truth be told, he probably gives more than 100% because he gives us the power and the ability and the grace to even keep our part. But God wants us to be in a right spirit. Notice, James tells us, wash your hands. Wash your own hands. It doesn't mean literally. I mean, it's not like you're going to get germs. He's talking figuratively about sin. Purify your own hearts. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. He's not wanting you to look at what other people are doing, you know, which is the American way, right? Many people in America live their lives on the basis of what everybody else is doing. And they totally disregard and ignore the commandments of God and the Word of God. I mean, people want to excuse their behavior, justify their behavior. So they look to the culture. They look at see what other people are doing instead of what the Word of God says. I mean, this is so common in our culture. So Christian people, and I've seen this in my 27 years of ministry, Christian people go out and they live in sexual fornication and they shack up with their partner before they get married and they play around with homosexual relationships and they look around to society to validate themselves as if somehow society was the thing that determined what's right and what's wrong. God says, that's perversion. That's sin. I know what's right and wrong. says the Lord. The morality of America, friends, has become perverted. I don't think I'm telling you anything you don't know. But if you follow that morality, it will lead you straight to the pit of hell. I fear for this nation, and I think you agree with me. I fear for the spiritual climate and atmosphere and heart of this nation because of it is choosing something other than the revealed will of God, clearly. But the wonderful thing here is that God doesn't say, I'm going to throw you into hell. He doesn't say that. Now, that was the attitude of James and John. Remember the two brothers, the disciples, sons of thunder, Jesus called them because they were so fiery in their temperaments. One time in the Gospels, some people weren't doing what they thought they should do, and they said to Jesus, do you want us to call down fire from heaven and blast them? And Jesus says, oh, man, you've got it all wrong. You don't have the right spirit. You don't have the heart of God. God doesn't say, I'm going to destroy you, although he very well could. He has the right. He has the power. He could, but he's a gracious God. And here in James, he says, wash your hands. Purify your heart. Well, how do you do that? I think verse 9 unpacks that for us. James says, let's start with this. Grieve. Over what? Over your sins. Mourn. Over what? Over your rebelliousness. Wail, weep, it means, over your disobedience. God's perspective on our sin is a lot different than ours, isn't it? Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. He's saying, repent. I read one commentator who said, it's time to get off the world's party train and stop thinking that the goal of life is to have fun and be happy all the time, and start thinking about sin and how desperately you need God. I kind of like that. Well, that leads us into the next section. In verses 11 to 12, where James tells us don't slander anybody else. He kind of comes back to this tongue thing again, you know, the things that we say. And he says, don't start making judgments about other people or being judgmental. I'll explain the difference. But we're still talking about pride here and this spirit of pride and what a proud attitude does in us, what it produces in us. And James says here, pride will cause you to put yourself above other people and judge them. But really, what you're doing is you're putting yourself above the law of God. Because the law of God is a law of love, first and foremost. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. That's the first and greatest commandment. And love your neighbor as yourself. That is the second commandment. And it's that law that James is talking about here in verse 11, the law of love. Now, let's talk about this because people get so hung up on this whole matter of judging other people. You know, I mean, how many times don't we hear this? You make a comment about somebody's lifestyle, like, oh, you can't judge me. Who are you to stand and judge me? You know, ooh, get way up in arms about it, just like I'm trying to get right now, so you kind of get the idea. There's not a clear understanding of this among believers. Last week, I think it was, maybe it was two Sundays ago, we talked about that within the fellowship of the body of Christ, we're supposed to be fruit inspectors, remember? That we're supposed to inspect the fruit in each other's lives. We're supposed to judge and examine one another's lives to propel us towards maturity in Christ, to grow in the grace and knowledge of Christ, to honor the name of Christ, that no shame could ever be brought to the name of Christ among us. That's why we do it. But we are not to pass judgment on those outside the church. Inside the church is one thing. Outside the church, no. Let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 5. That's right where this comes from, verses 9 to the end. And it's really verses 12 and 13, but I want to read verses 9 and following. I would invite you to turn to your Bible and look at this. I don't want you just to say, well, that's what Pastor Paul said. I want you to see it's right here in the inspired Word of God, okay? 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9. The background of this, just quickly, is that there was a man who was having a sexual relationship with his mother or his stepmother or mother-in-law, somebody who was like a mother in his life. And the Corinthian church was not dealing with it properly. The man was refusing to repent, and they should have expelled or excommunicated the man from the fellowship because he refused to repent, and they weren't doing that. And so Paul is enjoining them to take the proper steps. Okay, verse 9. I have written you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral people. Not at all, look at this verse, not at all meaning the people of this world who are immoral, or the greedy and swindlers or idolaters. In that case, you would have to leave this world. Boy, isn't that stating the obvious? But now I am writing you that you must not associate with anyone who calls himself a brother, and it means also a sister in Christ, but is sexually immoral or greedy, an idolater or a slanderer, a drunkard or a swindler. With such a man or person, do not even eat. Now look at this. Verse 12, what business is it of mine to judge those outside the church? Rhetorical question. It is no business of yours to do that. Are you not to judge those inside? Rhetorical question. Yes, you are supposed to judge those inside the church. God will judge those outside the church. Expel this wicked man from among you. So, friends, we are called to exercise wise and discerning, Holy Spirit-led judgment of those who claim to be followers of Christ. Now, we don't pronounce some kind of eternal judgment over people in the church or outside the church. No, that's not our job. In fact, James says here, there's only one lawgiver and one judge for that, the Lord, who is able to save or destroy. And God knows what he's going to do. Don't judge someone eternally, but judge the fruit. Judge the conduct. Judge their Christian living. We all need that. But clearly, we are not to make judgments of those who are outside of Christ, unbelievers. Why is that? Well, it's because they're simply acting according to their nature. They're not, you know, they don't have a new nature yet. They're still doing all the stuff that sinful people do, right? Hurting others, being rude, being insulting, being stupid, being whatever. They're just doing what sinful, immoral people do. And so we don't judge them. Does all of that make sense? I hope it does. So when James says here, at the close of the section, who are you to judge your neighbor? The inference is to a neighbor who's not a Christian. Not a Christian. Don't judge that person. They're an unregenerate sinner. They don't know any better. Lead them to Christ. Lead them to Christ. But listen, and now here, this is key. If a brother or a sister in Christ comes up to you and confronts you about some sin in your life, judges you, okay, they are doing exactly what the Lord says we should do. And you should welcome that rebuke, and you should go to the Word of God to see if what they are saying is right. And if they are, then you need to respond by, first of all, repenting of your sin and then thanking that brother or sister for having the courage, the patience, the love to confront you about your sin and get you on the path to righteousness. That's the response. And that's every believer's job, by the way. That's not just the job of a pastor. That's not just the job of our elders or the Sunday school teachers. That's every believer's job. St. Paul says that the body of Christ can only be healthy when every part and every ligament with which it is supplied is doing its part. Now, there will be things that go on in the body of Christ that I have no knowledge of. I've not heard about this situation, but you know about it. And your job, according to Matthew 7, is to, first of all, examine your own life to make sure that you don't have a plank in your eye when they've got a hunk of sawdust in their eye, to make sure that there's no open, unrepented sin in you. And then you go to that person after you've bathed it in prayer and asked for God to give you insight and wisdom and the words to say, and you go in the meekness and the gentleness and the compassion and the love of Christ, and you say, I gotta talk to you. That's how you do it. Now let's wrap up chapter 4. bring things to a close. In verses 13 to 17, James is still dealing with this whole spirit of pride issue that prevails in our lives. And, you know, one author calls pride the primal sin. Primal meaning it goes all the way back to the beginning. It was Adam and Eve's main sin that they were enticed into by the enemy, but really it was their own pride that caused the fall of man. Think about that. But what he's saying here is be careful not to be presumptuous about what you're going to do in the future. He's not saying don't make plans. We all make plans. It's okay to make plans, but there's a right way to plan and there's a wrong way to plan in your life. Making plans for your life as a believer without keeping God at the forefront and not without consulting the Lord's wisdom and seeking what the Word says about it and submitting yourself to the direction of the Holy Spirit would be foolishness. If you're a believer, you know, like, who should I marry? Well, maybe I'll just marry that person. They're cute, or they have a lot of money. It's like, what does God say? You know, we need to let the Lord order our steps and establish our lives. Unbelievers do those kind of things, and it gets them into all kinds of trouble, right? I mean, they're going through marriage after marriage. They're going through, you know, from one addiction to the next, you know, trying to figure life out because they just don't want to submit to God. But you, Scripture says, belong to God. Your life is not your own. Think about that. Your life is not your life. So you should always be thinking and saying, if the Lord wills. Because our life is nothing more than a mist, he says, a vapor. Poof, puff of smoke. We're out of here. Going home from church today, roads are slippery. Big semi, big tanker going down to the fuel depot. Runs right over Pastor Paul. He's gone. Just like that. We have no idea when that may happen. Most of us might be thinking about Georgie Barrett, who just passed a few weeks ago. For all she knew, Georgie was a very healthy person before she was admitted to Mercy Hospital. For all she knew, she had many years of health and happiness in front of her. But God had a different plan, and he took her home. I don't know why. You don't know why. Georgie didn't know why. But God knew, and it's God's will that matters. And more than that, it is God's will that dictates and determines everything, right? We can make our plans, but we need to be wise, and we need to plan with eternity in view. So I might say, you know, honey, let's go on vacation in Alabama this summer. And if we don't pray about it, and we don't say, well, if the Lord wills, if the Lord, you know, kind of adds his blessing to that, and we surrender it to him, you know, should we go? Not if we don't have peace from the Lord about it. Don't boast about what you're going to do, James says. And he ends this chapter with kind of an interesting comment that almost feels like it's out of place here. Verse 17, anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it sins. What he's talking about there is what we sometimes call the sin of omission. You know, sins of commission, the things that we intentionally commit, sins of omission, the things that we don't do that we should do. And James, throughout this letter, has really been kind of going after the sins of commission, right? Their speech, their conduct, you know, all the things that they were doing. And now he kind of gets to the things, well, you know, there's some things that you left out that you should have done. And just think about this. I mean, don't we all have those moments when we know God wants us to do something, but we kind of dig in our heels and we proudly resist or we just flat out refuse to do it? I mean, I could give you examples of that, countless examples throughout my life and even some pretty recent ones. Maybe the Lord puts it on your heart to help somebody and for whatever reason you just kind of excuse yourself. Maybe it's because you don't have the money that that person needs at the time, or you don't have the time to help them, or whatever. But you know where this principle convicts me the most? It's in sharing the gospel. Sharing the gospel with people. It's when I miss or I walk away because of fear or because of uncomfortableness, I walk away from an opportunity to share the faith of Jesus Christ and the love of Jesus Christ with another person. And their eternal soul, for all I know, could go to hell the very next day. and their blood is on my head. That's where this gets me. And I hope that gets you too. But you know what I've noticed about this? When we follow the Lord's guidance and we follow the Lord's prompting to help someone or to speak to someone, amazing things happen. I mean, they feel so many times immeasurably blessed or incredibly amazed at God. And it stirs up things in their heart about the love and the goodness of God that maybe they would not have understood or experienced in any other way. It is so exciting, friends, to follow the nudges of the Holy Spirit in this way. It makes the whole Christian life an adventure. It makes it a great adventure and a wonderful journey of being used by God Himself to sow love and blessing into people's lives day after day after day. It doesn't get any better than that. That's what life is about. You have the most remarkable, the most unbelievable experiences listening to God and doing what God tells you to do. But the key is submission. It's right where James starts in verse 7. Submit yourself then to God. Because you know what submission involves? Listening. Husbands and wives. Wives, submit yourselves to your husbands in the Lord because this is fitting. Do you think a submissive wife never listens to her husband? Won't happen. A submissive wife listens to her husband. And a good husband, a loving husband, listens to his wife. That was free. We have to submit ourselves to God. We have to yield to God. We have to be still long enough to be in the relationship, to know the voice, say, Lord, I hear you. I know that's you speaking. I know what you're telling me to do. Go to that gas pump on the other side of the station and give a track to that person or speak to the person working behind the counter or whatever it is, but I know the master's voice. And when he tells me to do something, I say, yes, Lord. And what an incredible thing this is. Now, if you're here this morning and you have no idea what I'm talking about, please understand that this is about a personal relationship. I mean, mortal, fallen, finite, sinful, broken human beings in a relationship with the Almighty God of the universe. That blows my mind. But it is not, you have to understand this because it's not about religion. It's about a relationship that is a daily walk with the Lord Himself and Him using us as His children to accomplish His purposes and for His glory to do things through our lives that just change the world. I mean, Jesus started with 12 guys and we're all here today because of it. Wow. But if you don't understand this, You won't understand it until you give your heart to Christ. That's what I need to say. You'll never get this until you understand that you've got to surrender. Submit yourself to God. Humble yourself to the Lord. Repent of your sin. Seek Christ because He's the only one who can bring you to the Father. He said that Himself. The only way to the Father is through me. So you've got to surrender. And you've got to deal with this sin problem in life. You've got to let it go. And you've got to let God do His work on that sin in your life. You're not going to conquer it yourself. Take it from one who knows. So, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and He will lift you up. He'll save you. How awesome is that? All right, guys, you can come on up. Let's bow our heads and pray, please. Father, thank you for your word today. Lord, it is a sharp, penetrating word that pierces to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow. It discerns the thoughts and attitudes of my heart and of all of our hearts. And Lord, we thank you for this living, active, rhema word of God that speaks so powerfully into us, Lord, and we pray that we would respond rightly. And Lord, if there's any person here this morning who has been wandering in a life of sin and of selfishness and of pride, serving themselves, catering to the flesh, enjoying the world, but they know that the condition of their soul is not right with you, that, Lord, you would just move upon them by the power of your Holy Spirit and you would draw them to yourself. Lord, your promise is that if you draw near to me, I will draw near to you. Lord, what a promise that is. But you want us to abase ourselves. You want us to grieve over our sin and to mourn over our rebelliousness. and to weep over our disobedience. So, Lord, bring us to that place of brokenness where we realize that there is no good in us, that all of our righteousness is truly as filthy rags before your supreme righteousness. And we would say, come, Lord Jesus, take me, I'm yours. Make me a new person. Change me from the inside out. Give me a new spirit, a new heart, and help me to live my life for you and for your glory now and always. Empty me of myself, as we sang about, Lord. Rid me of myself, and take me and make me your child. Lord, hear my prayer and have mercy on my soul. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.